Welcome to Open Minds. This is a new show for Bay TV, the second episode we've done, featuring Ed and Mark from the Open Minds group. And Cathy is our guest. Cathy is a photographer, aren't you?
Yep.
From Liverpool.
Yes.
But you've got a long interest in what you'd say
in this
is
sort of esoteric matters, yes.
Okay, today we're looking at the subject of evil, the nature of evil. And I just want to open with this kind of broad, open-ended question. What is evil?
It's the other end of a spectrum, isn't it? I feel it's a spectrum, and there's good and there's evil, and there's lots of grey areas in between.
I'd go with that. I think evil is a natural consequence of good, and in fact is a purpose for good. Without it, there's no good.
Yeah, without dark, there's no light.
So it's a kind of yin-yang
thing?
My wife said that just yesterday.
Yes, she did.
And I thought, that's a bright thing to say, the yin-yang thing.
Yeah.
So without evil, there can be no good and vice versa.
Well, you can't even recognise evil without good, and you can't even recognise good without evil. If everything was neutral, then what would we call... Well, we wouldn't have a word for good and evil, would we? There'd be no such thing.
And what about this grey area? Cathy, about the grey area in between.
Well, some philosophers have said that good and evil is really just a matter of appetite, and what you like and what you don't like can often come down to your personal morals and experiences, and also what's within your culture and your local history as well. What's good for us in our culture may seem evil to another culture. For instance, and this is a bit of a hot topic at the moment, female genital mutilation is seen as a good thing in many African cultures, but in our culture we see it as a very evil thing, and it's something that we prosecute. So it's not the same throughout the world, and it does depend on where you are and what's happening in your society at the time.
You could say that evil is a subjective topic, really, depending on which perspective you're coming from.
Perhaps the motive of the individual that is a good indicator of whether it is evil or not. So let's take, for example, people who might eat people. That's an interesting concept. So cannibals. Is cannibalism evil? Well, in that culture, it was probably okay. And certainly there have been cases...
About ancient cultures or head-hunting tribes that in Amazonia, that kind of thing.
Equally, cannibalism, when your plane has been lost in the Andes for several months...
It becomes a necessity.
It becomes a necessity, doesn't it?
Yeah.
So when is cannibalism okay and when is it not okay? Where do you draw the line? Where's that grey thing? Where does the grey line stop? It really is hard to judge. And for people who've not been there, like us, to make a judgment of where that line is impossible, because we're not there.
We don't know what we would do given those circumstances.
Yeah. I think intent is the key word. If your intent is necessity to survive because you're trapped because you've been in a plane crash, then you can understand.
Or if your intent is to do what your ancestors have done for hundreds of years and to eat people that you capture from the opposite tribe.
Then that's learned behaviour, isn't it?
That's learned behaviour. And is that therefore evil? Or not evil?
And you do get people who have lured people, on the internet.
Yes.
There's been these. There was a story where a guy lured somebody and killed him and ate him. But is that mental illness? Was he being driven by something in his own mind?
And wasn't there an instance, the internet baiting thing that you're talking about, where the guy at the other end was in agreement with
He wasn't lured, really. He wanted to take part in this whole kind of...
But it does horrify us, that, doesn't it? I mean, I don't know about you, it horrifies me.
Oh, that's not something I'd like to know, going on upstairs flat or something.
What, you mean the grooming thing?
Well, just the whole scenario horrifies me, to be honest.
The fava beans and the Chianti.
Now, was he evil or not? It's interesting, that, isn't it? Because there were some things he did that were good and some things he did that looked evil, but were just his nature. Mm. Done to him.
Let's come to the origins of evil. Is there... two questions, really. Is there an outside arbiter from which we can define what is good and what is evil?
You mean like God?
like a god, for example. And is there, and related to that, is how does, what are the origins of evil? So the biblical text would say, for example, that, you know, that there's a, angels have fallen, disobeyed God, and they were the kind of creators of evil, really.
Yeah, so why did they disobey God then, do you think? What did they not like that God was doing? Maybe they didn't like God was smiting the people on earth.
It was before that actually was recorded as happening. Yeah.
So. Have we created these fallen angels or Satan or the devil? Because then we can always say, well, it wasn't me that was being evil. I was tempted. I was tempted by these demons, or I was tempted by the devil. So what we're doing is we're kind of displacing our own evilness, if that's the correct word, onto somebody else who's tempted us.
So you're saying it's like a Jungian thing, that these are projections of our kind of shadow side. Is that what you're saying?
That's a good point, yeah.
I suppose so, yeah. I mean, in as much as if you look at the Genesis story, when God says to Eve, you know, why did you eat the fruit? And she then turns and said, the serpent bid me do it.
It was a snake.
So she kind of passed the blame off herself onto this supernatural creature, which was a serpent.
Yeah. Do you think there's a sense in which we do that?
I mean, as children, you know, quite often or not, children will have an invisible friend, won't they? And they will say, oh, no, it was Mimi, my invisible friend, that made me do it. Or even Mimi that took the biscuit. It wasn't me, it was Mimi, you know. And
that can be projected into adulthood as well, though. In the Great Genocides, I was only following orders.
I think you could argue that because humans have always had family situations or children and parents, that they've always had situations where children will create a fabrication to get away with doing something that mum and dad didn't want them to do or forbid them from doing. So you could argue that the Genesis, the story, just came from someone creating a story, that they just made up a story based on what they are like. And so the whole Bible thing is just some fabrication made by normal people. It's not some supernatural God thing that has been given to us. I mean, we could have done that ourselves.
Didn't people of ancient cultures use this kind of mythological language, which is kind of what Mark is saying, in order to communicate and help each other, really, to understand the human condition? You know, they didn't have the kind of scientific knowledge that we have today in our culture.
There, but I think I agree with you that it probably was like that, going back to those prehistoric times. You know, people would create these stories and myths around things.
But that doesn't mean that they didn't have mobile phones. Truth is absent from that, does it? Because, you know, there's such a thing as metaphorical truth. Yeah. So going back to the evil thing again, the difference between good and evil, I mean, we can talk about good and bad, but there is a line. There is a line which when we cross that line, or when somebody, a nation or a person crosses that line, most of us would say they've crossed the line. Mm. In terms of your spectrum, I understand the thing about a spectrum. Yeah. There's always grey areas and areas of contention.
Where I think the line is also very subjective to whoever's telling you that where that line is. Let's say governments tell us that someone's crossed the line. And they know that you will, as a population, believe it because of your culture or because they said so. A simple example is in the news just this last couple of days. We have a lord at the moment who's been a bit... he's done something wrong, hasn't he? But is it wrong? Morally, yeah. You could argue he's done something morally questionable, but I'll bet you that Jesus would have had something to say about that. Let him, without the sin, cast the first one. You know, so has he done something evil? Has he done something that deserves being pilloried by the entire population and all the media?
I suppose it depends where you set yourself up in society as well.
But then when you look at other things which appear to be much more evil, I mean, we don't want to get into the abuse thing, but the abuse story seems to be going on and on and on and on and on for decades. And there's no big issue from the establishment about that. But one man who does something which is a moral decision that he made is reprehensible. Requires him to resign and gets all the media front headlines. And I'm not supporting what he did, but other people do that. Lots of other people do that.
I think that's drawing the line.
So that's not evil, is it?
That's not really where I'm talking about the line is. I mean, I don't think his behaviour is inherently evil.
I think it's a good example, though, I think, of we draw lines arbitrarily. And the person who's drawing the line is either an individual who's decided, well, it was OK because I thought it was OK, or a government says, for whatever reason, they may want to say, they may want to influence the population to follow the next line by drawing a line in a particular place, or they just want to let someone off the hook.
I mean, I think I'm talking about, you know, let's take it something else in the news, the kind of ISIS crisis.
Yeah, I was going to get
you know,
to
the
that.
Beheading of people, the crucifying of innocent people, the raping of children and young women.
Now that is don't believe in the Quran.
It's beyond the pale that everybody, most kind of right-thinking people from right across the world in any culture would say that's wrong, apart from the kind of death cult that's perpetuating that, I think.
So are you asking the question, when does bad become evil?
Yeah, I am, actually. Mm. That's a good, very good way of putting it, Mark. What do you think?
But again, I mean, there's a grey line, isn't there? There are some people who would say certain acts are absolutely evil, and then other people would say, well, there are mitigating circumstances that make that not as evil.
So it's just
and
bad.
It really does depend from what direction, what perspective you're coming on. You know, people talk about a greater good. And, you know, maybe some of the people in ISIS are working from the idea of a greater good.
I'm going to have to interrupt you there, Mark. I'm sorry, because I asked you, we're going to our commercial break. And then after that, we're going to come back and carry on this discussion, pick up on that and then talk about acts of evil. So see you, everyone, after the break. Welcome back to Open Minds with the Ed and Mark from the Open Minds Group and our guest, Kathy, in the studio. We're talking about the nature of evil. Just to pick up on what you were saying, Mark, about this difference between, you know, when bad becomes evil. Do you want to pick up on that again?
Yeah, I mean, like we were just discussing then, you know, kind of it really does depend on the perspective on, you know, kind of what information you are given. We're just talking about ISIS. Yeah. And you were saying, well, what is the information that these people who have been radicalised?
We're getting the information from Murdoch Press, and people in America are getting the information from Fox News, which is even more sort of Christian extremist, right, if you like.
Yes,
yeah.
Yes.
But if you go to the Middle East, what they're seeing, like, for instance, in Iraq, is a hell of a lot of what we gently term collateral damage and drones killing children, etc. And they're feeling powerless. And they're feeling like they're feeling the need to fight back. Now, I don't agree with what ISIS are doing for 1 minute, but I also didn't agree with the war on Iraq. So who's evil is evil.
You could say a really controversial thing and say that the evil that is more calculated for the future manipulation of the whole population of the planet, the New Order, let's say, that evil is the ultimate, if you like. Because that's doing things in a very calculated way, in a very controlling and from a position of power position. You could argue that that's the worst evil, even though the incidence of the evil, so the manifestations of the evil may be less shocking at each moment when they happen. You know, so we're not actually beheading people in public, which really shocks the life out of me and I'm sure everybody else with a sensible head on them. Sorry, no pun intended really on that one. I should have meant it. But I think that if you very gently do evil deeds or bad deeds, which are part of an evil program, that's worse in my view.
To gain power over the people
into the future and ongoing. That feels worse.
Kind of evil, you think, possibly.
That to me, that is driven by, if there's such a thing as an evil entity,
but also
this
well,
being driven
what
by
evil,
that.
I mean, I've not got any children, but what evil would you commit to protect your children? What evil would you commit if someone hurt your children? Yeah. And, you know, I'm not trying to justify what is going on.
Thought process often doesn't happen in a situation
exactly.
like that because it's an instinctive animal thing.
People say, you know, God, if someone hurt my son or someone hurt my daughter, I would kill them. Do you know what I mean?
Isn't that just a bad thing to do, not an evil thing? Well, isn't that the difference between the two?
Well, I think it's a spiral, isn't it? It's a vicious spiral, a vicious circle. You know, again, another way of looking. It's an eye for an eye, isn't it? Which, in that part of the world, or maybe throughout the world, I don't know, is a
good people have done bad things. Good people have done bad things. And for whatever motivation.
And bad people have done good things.
And bad people have done good things. That is not, therefore, to me, the definition. If a good person doing a bad thing, that is not an evil person. That is not an evil deed. It's bad. It's wrong. And they may even know that. It's when that badness perpetuates and it changes the outlook on good and bad, and it becomes then bad is being done persistently with an argument that they can support deeply, and they just like films of people like in The Silence of the Lambs and those things where someone does something which is bad, but then likes it, and that is really evil in my view.
Kathy, what were you going to say something?
I was thinking about. We were talking about, but when you were talking about the manipulation, and two things sprung to mind. There was back to intent again. Yeah. So it, the definition of evil is what the intent is behind it, the motive, as you were saying before. But also, power corrupts. You often get people moving into positions of power to do good, and they are then surrounded by yes men and women, telling them how fantastic they are, how wonderful they are, and they're getting used to the trappings of this, and as they move further, and it's a saying, isn't it? Power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely.
They themselves may not notice that change.
No.
They may, you know, if you stopped a person and said, well, you know, are you still trying to do a good thing? They may think, well, yeah, of course I am.
Margaret
even
Thatcher
though they've
really
been corrupted,
she was good, and a lot of people still do. And personally, you know, and again, we're back to opinions of what's good and bad, or good and evil. But to me, she was very destructive. But she honestly really felt that she was doing the right thing.
Yeah. Well, did she?
I think she did.
I think she did as well. But how do we know? How do we know? We see people like Katie Hopkins, who I think everyone hates, but it's systematic. Maybe she's doing it because she's wanting that reaction. Maybe Mrs. Thatcher wanted to look like she meant everything, but she was making it all up because she was genuinely evil. I don't know.
And I suppose none of us can judge that.
That's where evil really kind of sits, I suppose. You know, there are a whole swathe of grey areas, but I suppose if you're going to have a definition, somebody who is doing bad knows that they're doing bad only for evil's sake.
Or whatever, yeah.
Yeah, they're not doing it for any greater good. Yeah. They're not doing it because they are protecting anybody. They are doing it purely for the sake of.
But yet again, another grey area that we've introduced there.
And ultimately, you don't know, do you?
Because
you don't know whether or not Margaret Thatcher.
we can't get inside her head.
Exactly.
Can we?
Yeah, exactly.
And it's very late now.
Yeah.
But I think. When someone does do something persistently bad and we start to see them enjoying those bad things, those very bad things, then you can start to argue about evil and
but
stuff like
that. Maybe that's a process.
But from their perspective, if they enjoy doing something, why would they think that was evil? I mean, would they see what they're doing as evil or just what they do?
Do you think we accept that people do this, but do you think we all have that potential within us? You know, so we have the potential for goodness, and we have the potential for evil.
That then takes us back to that Native American saying you were talking about, or the story of the son talking to the elder, and you know that the elder saying there are two types of people in the world. There's the type that does bad, and there's the type that does good. And you know, these people are both within us. And the child says,
wolf, didn't he?
Yeah, the child says, well, which one wins? And the elder says, the one that you feed. So. If you continue to give energy to the side of you, and we have that old thing on the cartoons from years ago with little angel on and the devil there, that's the choice that we're given. Is this the free will that the Bible talks about? I don't know.
Now, I think that's the difference between us and other animals. I think that was the gift that we have that other mammals don't have. We have the gift of even analysing or debating good versus evil. The concept of the good and the bad angel on our shoulders, the guilt that we feel or that we're encouraged to feel as from when we're born by society, that guilt, the feeling. I don't think other animals feel guilty. except if we make them like certain dogs. If you've got a pet dog, you'll know that
you
can make your pet dog, you know, cower in the corner when he's eating your shoes and you've just come in from work.
But I don't think he feels guilty. I think it's scared that the last time he ate the steak, it got a backhand,
right.
And
it may get
you know, the same thing again.
Yeah. I mean, they're conditioned to feel fear. And as a baby, there are just only a couple of things that we're born with. There's, in terms of emotions, it's fear of falling and fear of loud noises.
But from then
on, all the rest of the fears are driven into us by our environment. You know, so, you know, if animals only become afraid to a limited extent...
By conditioning,
yeah. You know, they know that... They learn that human beings are to be feared. Because we kill for the sake of it, don't we?
People become evil because of conditioning or as a result of the circumstances surrounding their life. And then there are people who are just born evil. You know, and
my opinion...
I want to change the track a bit now. Yeah. I want to talk about... there's a verse, again, in the Bible which says, love of money is the root of all evil.
Yeah.
Do we think that is true? That where there's greed, where there's a desire to create and keep great wealth, do you think that...
I think where there's an attachment to material things rather than a connection between people. I think there's a difference between the two things. And if a person goes down the materialistic route and starts gathering items that they'll purchase, you know, eventually, I don't know, Learjets, whatever, and that constant need to keep on carrying on is feeding something within them that's actually missing that could be replaced by connection and relationship with other people. And I think that there is a big difference between the two, and that one feeds the good and the other feeds the evil. So I do tend to agree with that.
And they'll do anything to keep it, right?
Mostly, yeah.
I think if you look in the Bible, you know, in the Gospels as well, that, you know, a lot of what Jesus was saying, he talked about the spiritual life was a life of putting on one side, you know, materialism and the pursuit of money. And he talked about, you know, the rich man going through the eye of a needle. Yes. You know, it was easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than a rich man to get into the kingdom of heaven. And I think it was this, that, and I wonder if that, you know, biblical quote is about, you know, kind of the spiritual life versus a life of materialism and earthly wealth.
And Buddhism says the same thing, doesn't it? You know, it encourages, you know, the discarding of material things and to live more on the spiritual plane. Yeah. And that connection.
And yes, you know, Jesus himself, in the stories of Jesus, and I'm going to, just for the sake of argument, believe in Jesus, if that's okay.
That's fine by me.
Right. And certainly in the character that we portray around the Jesus person, and say he lived with material things, you know, he ate and he worked and he had friends and he needed a place to live and so on. And he had material things. And you could argue that in those days he had probably more than he would find absolutely necessary to live as a human being.
I'm going to have to break it up now. Yeah. I really loathe to break it up at this point, personally. But we're going to our commercial break, and we'll come back to that after the break. And join us after our commercial break for Open Minds. Welcome back to Open Minds with Ed and Mark from the Open Minds Group and our guest, Kathy. We're talking about the nature of evil. Just wanted to let Ed finish off what he was saying about Jesus there, because I interrupted you for our commercial break.
And you know, I was really off on a roll there.
Yeah, you lost a thread now.
Jesus, I think, I'm not sure what I said exactly before the break, but I think I was going on about Jesus had a lot of emotion, but he also had a need to survive in a material world. And so he had a home, which we don't know for sure, but may have been more than he would absolutely have needed. We never hear stories of him living under a large leaf in the wintertime.
He does say, though, I mean, especially in his 3 years that he had his mission.
Yeah.
He does say, you know, the foxes have their holes, the birds have their nests.
We're kind of getting off the point now, but what you were saying about evil and money and Jesus, just to
absolutely. So just to whiz on to mention. So, you know, possession of material things, I don't think you could argue that, let's say, Jesus was after the possession of material things. He was after the development of his spirit and spirit in the connection with other people. So do unto others as you would have do to you. A lot of statements he came out with, or is given the credit of a lot of statements which are about people, about society, about social things. He never ever made a positive statement about money, except whatever is Caesar's give unto him.
He also said, or is accredited of saying, a charity begins at home. And I take that as meaning that you can't help others until you've helped yourself first. You've got to get yourself to a certain point before you can...
I want us to get back to the subject of evil. I want us to come on and talk about whether people are... about serial killers, such as Fred West, Fred and Rosemary West, Jeffrey Dahmer, Ian Brady. I mean, there's lots of different names we could throw up. Despots, you know, like Pol Pot and Hitler and Stalin. People are fascinated, aren't they, by these characters? Why do you think, and they're fascinated by the evil that they do? If it wasn't, it's like the craze.
We like to be shocked, don't we? Let's face it. But because I don't want to believe in an inherent evil outside of people that can come into people and possess them, I really don't want to believe that. So I would prefer to go down the route that these people are sociopaths and they have a mental health condition and have always had or have developed a mental health condition that stops them from having any compassion for anybody else or any feeling for any societal rules, and that they just want to do what they want to do and the consequences do not matter, and that it becomes almost a game, a hunt. They're the hunted by the police or whoever, but they're also hunting other people, and it's a sport that they're doing.
But they become intoxicated by it, don't they? If you see my point. They have this idea of a state that they want to produce in the, like Hitler had this idea of a new Europe, yes, that was Aryan race.
Yeah.
And you know, that idea, for it to be implemented, would require some really bad things to be done.
He thought he was doing a good thing, didn't he?
And you know, he did see, for example, that the British were very like him in terms of the ideals for the future.
And creating connections as well with the early Nazi Party prior to the Holocaust years and prior to, you know, them becoming what we now consider to be Nazis. They had strong connections with the royal family, which have been talked about recently in the newspapers.
So
there would have, it would have been a natural connection
to make.
But I think
when you do bad things, I think we were talking about this before, when you do bad things continuously, you know, your decision-making process, when someone gives you an ethical decision to make, is impaired by experience, your own internalizing of the many bad things you've done. You know, so where
the
you might have been, you might have been less inclined to say, kill that person now, when you first did it. But when you've done it and the consequences seem to be in line with your overall principles, it's easy to say, kill all of them. Mm-hmm. You know, the human life and things which are seen to be good become just, it doesn't matter. It's pointless. It's not as important anymore.
It's when you, I think as well, you become obsessed with the ends and everything in
and
between
means,
suddenly just becomes superfluous. You're driven to get to this end point and literally wipe everything else out of the way.
The end point is good. So, you know, you can think of in terms of the caliphate, which ISIS are trying to create, a global caliphate. In their eyes, the end point would be almost like a utopia, a heaven on earth, that they're trying to create. But you can commit these acts of evil in order to achieve this greater good at the end.
In the Second World War, you know, I mean, the Allied forces carpet bombed Dresden.
Yes.
But the ends justified those means.
Well, that's Hiroshima and Nagasaki.
Exactly.
It was to terrorize the population into submission.
That was, was an evil act. But people become obsessed with the ultimate point, the end point.
I'm just trying to get into Hitler's head again here for a minute. I'm just trying to think, you know, in the sort of early 30s, late 20s, early 30s, when Germany had a very poor economy, his idea was he wanted to strengthen the economy, and his way of thinking was big drain on the economy is gypsies and the itinerant, and the other people who were seeping or taking all the money from the economy was the Jewish community. So those two had to be eradicated in order to strengthen the economy. And
so
I'm
we're
assuming,
talking about,
is this a logical thing going on in his head?
Is the greater, you know, he thought he was committing he was committing these acts in order to achieve a greater good, and they were necessary. So we're talking about that expression, a necessary evil. That, I mean, that's what he believed.
Yeah. Saying earlier that we got people who we might today term as sociopaths, if not psychopaths, and when they're put in a position of power, we would argue that the judgment of someone like that is so extreme that it is impaired. And so Hitler's judgment, in order to gain his ideology for his future vision, he's judging that all these other things have to be done in an extreme way.
And maybe he wasn't even thinking of the extremo. Maybe it was those directly beneath him who were the sociopath, psychopath people who thought, here's an opportunity for me to experiment on people.
Yes, that's a great point.
Maybe it wasn't him
who was the evil one. It was those who worked for him because they had the long-term greed and personal gain to follow through his instructions and then blame him.
In their way, in a way that satisfied
him.
That's interesting. Let me pick up on this, actually, because you're saying, you know, maybe it wasn't him. So have we taken the whole kind of Nazi thing, which a lot of people consider to be, you know, a great chapter of you know, unremitting kind of evil in Western European history, and we've kind of loaded it on this one person, and he's become like a symbol for everything.
He's the only name that's really kind of left resonating in our minds, so we can offload all that. We offload all that evil onto him.
Ah, but there's a good one. Simon Wiesenthal, who was the big Nazi hunter, so he wasn't just offloading onto one person, he was after everybody who was involved, yes. And it was him, I mean, I'm paraphrasing here, but all it takes for a good man to do evil is to stand by and do nothing at all in the face of it. And so
it's really interesting. If a group of you who are evil people, who have evil intent for the future, basically based on personal achievement and greed and selfishness, if you want to achieve that, find someone, maybe amongst you or maybe someone who's not one of that team, who is great with PR, who can really rally everybody, the whole population.
Like Goebbels in Hitler's case.
Like Hitler, who can stand up and rally everyone around them. Charismatic.
Great orator.
Absolutely. Mm. But is a nutcase, is a total fruitcake, but they know it. They can blame that person, and they watch this fruitcake rally the people and then make him, wind him up, into doing the evil things.
So
but from a position of illness.
Are you saying there was somebody else behind, say, Hitler?
Well, I'm speculating.
What we do know is, you know, that he didn't actually personally perpetrate these acts of evil.
Yeah.
He might have put out orders to somehow get rid of the gypsies, somehow get rid of the Jews. Yeah. I don't know. I wasn't there.
And gay people and all the rest of it.
Perpetrated these things, chose ways in which to do that fulfilled their own.
But he also wanted to eradicate them because they didn't fall in line with his idea of the perfect human specimen.
Absolutely, yes.
So there was also the idea, if he managed to take over the world, let's say, they had to be eradicated because they didn't fit the Aryan model.
If someone is mentally ill, their capacity to judge good from evil or good from bad is impaired, certainly in terms of consequences. On themselves or on others.
There's a lack of compassion.
There's a lack of compassion, perhaps, in that individual understanding. So to blame someone who is ill, and let's presume for the moment that Hitler was seriously mentally ill. I don't think many people watching this would disagree that Hitler was seriously mentally disturbed. But being used for his other charismatic qualities.
And also being set up for a scapegoat.
Being set up. So
Is that what you're saying, though? Are you saying that Hitler was a scapegoat, really?
Yeah, he would make sweeping judgments and instructions. Kill them all. Just do this. Bomb that. Do the blah, blah.
Just, again, taking it down...
Am I getting you too excited here?
taking it down a different route, slightly. This whole idea of symbolising, you know, creating symbols of evil. Yeah. Just thinking about the literature, the books. We're going to... The books on criminals that are sell really well, you know, the Krays and all these kind of characters.
Yeah.
Do we think, and we're probably going to have to come back after the break to really look at this because we're running out of time now, but do we think that we project onto these people the tension that exists within ourselves between good and evil and good and bad?
We always need someone who is more evil than us to say, well, yeah, I'm bad, but look at him.
So you can point the finger that way.
We have actually come to the end of this of this section. We'll see you after the commercial break when we come back for the remaining quarter of Open Minds. Welcome back to Open Minds. We're having a very animated discussion here in the studio on the subject of evil, the nature of evil. We've been talking about projecting our own inner tensions that we all experience around our own inner goodness and badness, if you like, and propensity towards doing things that aren't right.
We're projecting those onto
these symbols that we set up, these personifications of evil, which are in the press, which are on our bookshelves, and
isn't it true that when the authorities catch and convict one of these serial killers, maybe we're still child murderers, and they drive them out of the court in the big van, there's hundreds of people screaming at them in the street, I look at them and think, my God, that's a mob.
They really frighten me.
They frighten me more than the guy in the van.
Yeah.
Because from
they would rip that person from limb to limb.
From them, you know, they're judging, okay, they've been judged by the law and they may be guilty, but we don't know what is going on inside that individual.
But quite often they haven't even been judged by the law and the lynch mob is there. Yeah. It could even be
before
a mistaken
they even go
identity.
In,
and the lynch
and
mob
so
would be
we've
there.
We've got the lynch mob mentality all over. And you know, this projecting thing, I think the lynch mob is a perfect example of an extreme projection of your own tensions onto somebody else.
I think as a society, we need those vessels from time to time
to
literally kind of, like you say, project our venom, our hatred onto somebody. And, you know, a criminal...
To relieve the tension in ourselves.
Yes,
but we do like that purging ourselves. That's how we set up our enemies, isn't it? So we set up, we did it with Saddam Hussein. We did it we did it with Colonel Gaddafi.
A bit more than the lynch mob.
Yeah.
That we're talking about something which I think is manipulated and constructed very carefully behind closed doors. The propaganda machine that discredits the ones who they want to get or the ones who stand in the way of them getting what they want.
Yes.
And I think the discrediting machine, the propaganda machine, is much more evil than the lynch mob down the road. And, you know,
because
you talked about the lynch mob making...
The intent, again, isn't it?
Is a premeditated intent of a future which is about certain individuals having more than the others.
Does our society... Sorry, I mean, you were talking about, you know, kind of archetypal evil people, the people that... We need them in our society, to make our society survive. We need people who are more evil than us.
Yes.
Because if we didn't have those evil people, we'd start looking at ourselves. We'd start looking at perhaps the bad that we do. But if we've always got someone who is worse than us, then
where does that end?
Better of ourselves.
What you're advocating is escalating evilness. Because if you see someone more evil than you and they want to see someone more evil than them, where does that end?
You have to have
some tempering of that where you flatten it to a level which is this is the new norm. If you look at the norm today in society, bad thing or things that were seen to be really bad in the past are now okay. aren't they?
But do what I was going
to
say.
We've raised the level of the norm of badness. That's acceptable. Yeah. It's no longer bad to do things that used to be bad.
Yeah, yeah.
In olden days, a glimpse of stocking was looked on as something shocking.
That's a good.
That's a good
cue for a song.
Could I just ask a question about? I just really want to nail this really in this last section. I'm coming back really to the origin of evil that we talked about at the beginning. You said that you didn't believe that. What did you say?
I feel that the universe is neutral. I prefer to feel that because I don't like the idea of having forces outside of me controlling how I operate or how other people operate. But then again, there are forces outside of me controlling that, and that is the media, that is the propaganda machine and what I'm taught. But I do prefer to think of the universe as a neutral force. It terrifies me, the heaven and hell thing.
Yeah, I...
And the devil.
I mean, I put my cards on the table. I'm somebody who does believe in powers and principalities, and I believe in angels, and I do believe in demonic forces. I think there are powers outside. I'm not saying they control us, but I think they influence us. Okay. I mean, what do we think about this whole thing about being possessed, by people being possessed or oppressed by evil forces? Which, I mean, what do you guys think? I mean, you've said that...
That's premised on us believing in the demonic, isn't it, though? If we have no belief in that, then there's no answer to your question, is there? Really?
Well, I have no belief in it, and I think my answer to the question would be a person that somebody with your beliefs might consider a demonic possession, I might consider them to be having either... to be some combination of schizophrenic and having epileptic fits.
I mean, if you don't mind me saying, it sounds like what you're saying is that you... It's not that you disbelieve these, you fear believing it, rather.
Probably, yes. Yeah,
I mean,
that's
how
it
comes across to me. Mm-hmm. It's a kind of a fear of actually believing that actually this kind of world might be correct.
I feel more comfortable being an atheist and believing that the universe is neutral. And I also have, we're talking about evil and retribution maybe. A lot of people, you say, oh, don't worry about it. What goes around comes around. Well, actually, it doesn't a lot of the time. Idi Amin, isn't he still alive and well in the Middle East, living life? Yeah. But, you know, within the same lifetime rather than karma over lifetimes. Yeah. And I think that takes away people's ability to get their own back or get revenge, but to put things right that were wrong.
I think, you know, the view that says that the universe isn't neutral, that there are, you know, these, you know, not competing forces, but there is forces of, you know, God, forces of good and forces of evil, also posits that there's a judgment. Which is like a court, really, ultimately they will pay.
What's the physics that says matter is neither created nor destroyed? And I think you can still have matter and no matter, but there's a neutral position in the middle that just says what you have is what you have, that you can't add it or take it away. So it can sometimes be very that way or very that way, but ultimately it balances to the middle, which is, I think, what you're saying, that there's a neutral situation in the universe. And I think that applies to good and evil, the energies that are associated with good and evil, as well as energies associated with matter. So there is a balance, but we will find times where we swing from one end to the other, and it will then balance itself out again, neutralize itself again, or move. The next 20, 30 millennia, we could see a completely different position in terms of our view
cultures,
of
cultures. Like I was thinking about, you know, the American the slavery and people of color in America. They got great comfort from believing that they maybe in the only way they got through it was by believing that ultimately there would be a judgment between good and evil, and the people that were oppressing them.
That could be seen as a political manipulation to keep them in that position, because ultimately they would have that retribution at the end, or that, you know, they would go to heaven and the other sinners would be punished. Maybe if they didn't have that belief, they would have rallied sooner and revolutionised things sooner.
I think the idea of heaven and hell kind of predated, the slave trade. I think that the idea that there is a hell, that the evil people will ultimately
be punished is something that, again, that
well,
we that
I'm
we
not necessarily
need.
Talking about hell, I'm talking about judgment, which is...
Judgment, are you talking about judgment from God? Are you talking, what type of judgment
well,
are you
personally,
talking?
I'm talking about judgment from God, that ultimately...
Well, there's a consequence of that judgment, isn't
there? Ultimately, evil will be dealt with.
Yes.
And
that is dealt with by, that is dealt with usually, in a biblical sense, by hell.
Well, that's, yeah.
Just yesterday, I was saying again to Mark earlier that yesterday I was visited for the first time in a couple of years by witnesses at the door. Now, I think Jehovah's Witnesses are usually really nice people. They're very respectful people, and they're sometimes given a really rough time, aren't they? Because they don't mean harm. But at the end of the conversation I was having with them, they were talking about the result of a judgment coming from God will come to clear the evil up, is that the good will be in heaven. And they even, these two particular guys even suggested that heaven was this planet. Earth is our heaven. It's the future of the human race is to be in heaven, and only the good will remain and those others will go. And that sits nicely with me, because I think this planet is a beautiful place.
Well, that's a useful point to end on, really. We're coming to the end now. If I can have the final word, the Bible talks about a new heaven and a new earth, that God will create a new heaven and a new earth, and everything will be, and evil will be dispensed with. Mm. And that's a note of hope, perhaps, to end on. I know you guys might not believe that, but join us for the next show, where we're going to be talking about hope, and we're going to be talking about truth and lies and deceptions, and hopefully a bit of hope at the end. I hope that I've ended on a note of hope. It's great to have you again in the studio, and join us for our next episode of Open Minds.